Bom tarde, senhoras e senhores. I'm very happy to be here again. This is my third time. And all of you have seen a lot of wonderful sessions today. It's 5 p.m. You're probably tired, but you're excited. You have great ideas how to implement in your business. And now we're going to have a fun panel. We're going to discuss similarities and differences in BRIC countries in e-commerce. And during the time, please think about the questions they're going to ask us. And at the very end, I'm going to have a surprise for you, a bonus that you will use in the next 48 hours. So are you ready? Awesome. So if we're thinking about e-commerce in BRIC countries. Okay, I need someone to help me. Okay. Which one? Okay. So if we're looking at the e-commerce in BRIC countries, there is one big similarity that all of us have, and you cannot ignore it anymore. The entire world cannot ignore it. Can you guess, can anyone volunteer guess what it is? Can anyone say what it is? One similarity that all four countries, four regions have. Brazil, Russia, China, India. Anybody? Well, oh, I just have. It is market size. Market size is something that all four regions are famous for, and the rest of the world is paying attention. And it is so big that it matters. In fact, there were studies have done in the US that by the year of 2015, Brazil will be able to make up to $25 billion. Russia has the potential of $38 billion. India ranges within 11 to 38 million. And China, which is the biggest one, probably because of the population as well, is $443 billion. This is huge. And so the rest of the world cannot ignore that. So what are the things that we have in common, all four of us? Well, I call it local or eccentric government. And what I mean by that is you cannot deny that the Russian government has eccentric habits and well known to the world. And then we have China that doesn't allow you to use internet fully and gets into your privacy, which impacts e-commerce as well. And then we have India, which is so full in red tape. I think by the time they will get into the regulation and for e-commerce, it will take another 5 years or more. And of course, Brazil, you know what it is for you, yourself. Since I'm a guest in this country, I'm not gonna have any visual for you because I still wanna get home and don't wanna say anything. But you know what it is for your country. Then, the government is something that we really cannot affect very much as industry professionals, maybe later on, but there are problems and similarities that we have that we can solve, and that comes to logistics. Logistics must be built in Brazil, in Russia, in India, in China, and it literally means you have to bring people into that. You have to create third-party companies that do logistics. You cannot rely on what is available. For example, in Russia, Ozon.ru, which is Russian Amazon, they have to create their own courier service. Here in Brazil, even one of the speakers in who just joined forpets.com Brazil, he's trying to contribute into the infrastructure of Brazil as well. But it's not that easy. It's not like you can hire anybody, any school person to do delivery. Fulfillment is very important for your business, and it requires skilled individuals to do so. In India, it's even more problematic because there is this instance of fraud, and but you have to deal with that, and you can do that. And then we have this cash payment. Now, in Brazil, you already resolved this issue, and later one of our speakers will share how it has evolved over time. But when it comes to Russia, people still prefer to pay in cash. And most of it because they don't trust the banking system, and the banks are very self-serving, and they don't trust the government either. For example, my parents, they lost all their savings at the age of 50 during the Iron Curtain fall down, and they had to start everything from scratch. They had to go on the streets and sell stuff so that they can afford college education for me and my sister. And so a lot of people, you know, really start hiding their cash in mattresses, and it still shows up in the e-commerce right now because people prefer to pay in cash. In the United States, it's not a big problem, but you do see parts of it with Walmart and other big retailers targeting immigrants that come in without papers, they don't have access to credit cards, and they pay with cash. And then we are going to the differences. There is one good saying that we have to share the similarities, we have to find them and connect with them, but we need to celebrate our differences because in the differences we can see opportunity how to solve some similar problems or how to profit on what we have so far. And if we look at all four countries or four regions, Brazil, Russia, India, and China, there are two main elements where the differences occur. The environment, which includes the physical and the industry, and the culture, which is very unique and will never change. And what do I mean by that? For example, in India, right, offline retail can be so painful. I mean, there are so many, if you're going to get a soap or something very basic, all those merchants all over the place, I mean, it's a crazy city, pollution, you don't want to get there. The offline retail is horrible. And so online retail becomes very attractive for busy professionals. Or, for example, in Russia, a lot of, there is a big population, big market, as you have seen, but a lot of it, all infrastructure is around Moscow, the so-called the Golden Circle, which is not only a tourist expression. And so it's very hard to reach customers that are in other parts of the country, like Sakhalin Island, where I'm from, which is 8 time zones away. But you have to really play with them. And then China, we all know that the low level of human life exists in China, and people drop in the factories. Well, the same happens in e-commerce. There are people who are running their online stores on marketplaces, and they run themselves to death. So that's very cultural. That's not something we can solve, but that exists there. And then Brazil, you know, I see a lot of people I know in the industry who like to go to United States to go shopping there. They go to United States with empty luggage, and they come with a lot of stuff back. So there is very interesting pattern that you can engage into if you are trying to launch any specific store. And so if we're looking at all those four regions, and we want to focus on very specific cultural traits that will never change and we want to profit on, there are four that I identified. So with Russia, it has to do with giving it all to the beauty. Russians love to dress up. From the age of 7, you grow up and you learn how to dress very nicely, and people treat you differently if you don't dress very well. And Russians spend a lot of money on luxury fashion clothing. I mean, my sister, she spends up to 20 grand a year on her clothing. I think that's too much money, even for me, and I live in America. But Russians are paying attention to fashion. They're buying clothes from French retailers, UK retailers, and there are some of them that are coming to Moscow and set up their stores and online stores. And then we have China. Everybody knows that people eat everything in China, everything that moves. Well, that applies also to e-commerce. The best business model in China is marketplaces, and literally you can buy anything and sell anything in China. And if you are trying to set up your business, even if it's in the US, you need to know that because you can get suppliers or you can already buy something. You don't need to produce. And then in India, I call it the flying carpet. Travel industry, travel niche is very popular, is very good. And now they're adding other related goods as well. So you can really see why it works there, because it's very culturally driven with the matrimonial arrangements and family stuff. And then, of course, Brazil. All of you here are very beautiful people. I swear to God, every time when I come here, I'm tired after 12 hours on the plane, the first thing I notice is the beauty in people. I just stare and I stare, even if I'm tired. And of course, you know, the first thing you see at the airport is the posters of Gisele. And you do know that Brazilians spend the most money on beauty and health products. That means that you have really high demand for this specific item or category. And you do still have problems with tax and import, but maybe you can still solve it. Maybe there is a different business model, like subscription model, because the demand is super high. All those women go into US with baggage, with a lot of stuff from it. They are the best customers you can ever have. So you need to figure out a business model that works around the taxes and import stuff that is imposed by your government. And so, what can we learn from it all? The six things that I identified that go throughout this is definitely tapping into the culture. That's the first thing you need to do. And then you need to solve what you can first, which is logistics. In fact, some of the people that spoke today, including Andrea from Survivor, is trying to do that. And then you try to adopt marketplace model, because this way you can spread the risk that you have. And you need to partner up with your competition, because you're in together. You have the government that's meddling into and is not helping at all. So partnering up with your competitors, even if they're foreigners, can be good for you. And that's what some companies do here in Brazil. And of course, investing in technology and people, trying to educate. And a lot of things are done here with this specific conference and with ESPM and other institutions. And again, dare to be different, because the government is not going to change, and but you can. So definitely try to do that. So this is all high level to warm you up. By now, you should be having some questions. Okay, like, what are the differences? How can I use that and that? Start thinking and getting those questions. If you need more detailed information, I can provide you the list of top 10 retailers in all those four regions. You just have to email me and let me know about that. Also, I have another bonus for you, the second bonus. This October, I'm actually launching a book on e-commerce. It's called Growing Scale Online Store to Profit. And I have 50 online retailers all over the world who are contributing to their stories, their success stories, including some people here, like Ian, Andre Alves, Sandra Turci, even a new startup, Primo de Durare from South Brazil, and many more. And in that book, there will be stories from those countries, how they solved some of the issues, so that you get a sense. Now, I have a limited offer for all of you here. If you either email me at contact@commercebrain.com or go to commercebrain.com/profitbook, within the next 48 hours, you will get a free copy of this book, together with the one pager. So, and now, we're gonna move to our rock stars in the Latin America. We have Malte and Pedro, and they're gonna tell you how they're gonna apply, how are they applying all these lessons that they see in their respective companies. I'm gonna ask them a few questions, and then you will take over with your questions. Sounds good? All right. So we're gonna start with Pedro, can you tell us more about what do you see, what are the similarities in Brazil that maybe we spoke about the cash and it's something that has been resolved already. Can you share the evolution of this and how it came about and also touch the government piece?
Okay. I have opportunity to speak in English, German, Portuguese and English, but I prefer to Portuguese, okay? Sorry. Eu vou desenvolver em português, é mais tranquilo para entendimento e para as ideias. Bom, como foi apresentado pela Yulia, a principal característica dos BRICS, exceto aqui Brasil, é o pagamento por dinheiro, cash on delivery. Nós aqui no Brasil já estamos, já resolvemos esse problema. Nós temos o e-commerce há praticamente 15 anos no Brasil e nós tivemos a oportunidade de desenvolver meios de pagamento específicos para o canal de e-commerce. Nós temos aqui no Brasil pelo menos 3 ou 4 soluções, Bcash, nós temos PayPal, nós temos o UOL, enfim. E temos também oportunidade de pagar através de boleto. Ou seja, aqui no Brasil, pagamento através de dinheiro realmente somente para alimento, né? Quando você compra através de pizza ou qualquer produto alimento. Nós temos aqui no Brasil uma característica também muito forte com relação aos BRICS, a questão tributária. Nós temos aqui uma carga tributária relativamente alta, muito alta, né? Próximo a 40%. E nós temos uma outra questão que é muito similar, que é a questão da intromissão governamental dentro do nosso mercado de e-commerce. Nós temos os nossos ilustres deputados e senadores sempre buscando implementar leis, obviamente, tentando facilitar a vida do consumidor, que é correto, mas aqui no Brasil, muitas vezes, o setor ele não é ouvido. Nós já vimos diversas leis sendo implementadas, impostas para o setor. Nós sabemos do problema da guerra fiscal entre os estados, que complica muito a entrega dos produtos para os consumidores. Nós tivemos recentemente a aprovação aqui em São Paulo da lei do agendamento com período, entrega agendada, conhecida a lei da entrega com hora agendada, em que numa cidade como São Paulo, onde nós temos problemas de acesso, nós temos problemas de trânsito, isso praticamente inviabiliza essa lei. E recentemente nós tivemos também a medida provisória 615, que está trazendo a obrigatoriedade dos meios de pagamento alternativo, os facilitadores de pagamento provavelmente terem que ficar abaixo de uma instituição financeira. Enfim, eu acho que essas questões são questões que são trazidas e muitas vezes sem consultar os varejistas, e isso traz muito problema para o setor.
Então, But can you tell me about how you helping to resolve this government issue? Because you are part of the agency already, and you are probably educating the government how important e-commerce is. Can you tell me about the developments and the work that you do there?
Can you tell me about the development of?
You know that the government is one of the pains that we, all four of us have. And I know that you, in addition to Buscap a position, you also hold a position in a governmental agency,
like e-commerce.
Exactly. So, how do you deal with maybe educating the government on the issues? Yeah.
Nós fazemos trabalho junto à Câmara Brasileira de Comércio Eletrônico e junto à FEComércio, onde eu sou presidente do Conselho de E-commerce, que é justamente conversar com os deputados. Nós temos através da Câmara Enet, nós buscamos, junto com representantes dentro do Senado Federal, dentro do Congresso Federal, levar para esses parlamentares a realidade do setor. Então, recentemente, nós buscamos um deputado aqui de São Paulo, onde a gente, dentro do Conselho, traz esse deputado e traz os representantes das empresas para mostrar a dificuldade do setor e trazer esse deputado, ouvir a gente e colocar para, aqui em São Paulo, na Câmara, na Assembleia Legislativa, uma lei que possa equilibrar e também trazer a realidade do setor e levar a obrigação deles nos ouvir antes da implementação dessas leis. Então, isso é muito importante. O setor tem que nos ouvir, porque senão cada deputado em cada estado do Brasil vai implementar leis que vai inviabilizar totalmente o comércio eletrônico.
And now we also have Malte, who leads Dafiti, and his company is actually entering the whole Latin America. So Malte, can you share more, what are the similarities and differences you see between the countries of Latin America?
Yeah, sure. I think before I get started, I would like to say one more thing, I think, and that's a great similarity of all the BRIC countries and entire Latin America, actually. I think we're sitting on a huge opportunity, and this is because basically we are sitting on two mega trends. One is the emerging market trend, right? I mean, the emerging markets are still, despite, you know, a little bit smaller growth now over the last year and this year, are still countries that will be growing much faster than the average of the world. This is the first mega trend. The second mega trend is the pure penetration play. Today, I mean, I looked up the numbers today. I think e-commerce in Brazil today is something like 3.4% of overall retail sales. In China, we're about 4%. Russia, only 2%. And India, I don't know, it's about this range as well. And if you compare those to more mature markets like the UK or the US, you know, we see numbers like 10%, right? So this huge trend is still in front of us, right? I mean, we've only reached very small penetration of e-commerce yet. And those are the BRIC countries, right? Now, if I compare this also to the countries where we're also present with Dafiti, you know, Argentina, Chile, Colombia, and Mexico, there the penetration is even smaller. So, you know, this is basically the first thing to say. I think the biggest similarity is that we're sitting on a huge opportunity when it comes to BRIC countries. And now it's really only about, you know, ripening those fruits. It's really about, you know, adapting yourself to the local necessities and make your company grow, right? And if you compare a little bit, all of these aspects were mentioned during the presentation, but I think if you look at, for example, Brazil and you compare it to a country like Colombia or, you know, Mexico or Chile, you know, the main differences really are, for example, Mexico and Colombia, we have, you know, we had to deal with the very low credit card penetration. In Brazil, the credit card penetration is something like 115%. That means that on average, every Brazilian has more than one credit card. I think in the US, it's even two, right? I think it's even more. But in Mexico, this penetration is around 30% only. So this automatically leads to the question, you know, how will my customers pay? They do have boleto payment as well, but, you know, do they all want to do it? No, they have a very strong preference towards cash on delivery, which is basically what Yulia also mentioned in Russia, cash payment when you actually receive the goods. So we, you know, also had, when we entered the market, to adapt our strategy in terms of payment methods and logistics to the local requirements. You know, we had to basically also learn again. You know, we said, okay, you know, we rolled out the Fiji in Brazil, so, you know, it cannot be that hard to roll it out in the other countries as well. But, you know, every country is really different, and those are, you know, and the cost of the cash on delivery delivery thing is one of the examples of how really every country is a little bit different.
And if you compare the four countries, if you can stack them up, like which one picks up the fastest when it comes to becoming better in e-commerce, can you say which one is that? Get a sense?
So I think Argentina is the most prone e-commerce country, you know, after Brazil, obviously. But, you know, I think main reasons are, you know, the middle class is already established. You have a high penetration of internet and a high penetration of credit cards. So that's a very favorable country for us. But, you know, the other countries are also very, very good for us, right? For example, in Colombia, the opportunity is to really, I mean, there's two pure e-commerce companies, right? There's another rocket venture, Linio, which is general merchandise, and there's Dafiti, besides all the travel companies and Groupons of the world, right? But, you know, there we have the chance to actually, you know, build the market, form the market, educate people to buy online.
And so within your company internally, do you have people exchanging ideas like, well, that worked in Argentina, should we try to do that? Do you have like an internal console, or how does it work internally?
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, it's sometimes funny, right? Despite the differences, many things work in all the countries the same. So, for example, if I look at my marketing, when we had, you know, started display marketing, for example, in Argentina and Chile, the local marketing would always say, "Ah, no, those banners that you guys use in Brazil, they don't work here." The Argentinian said, you know, we're a little bit more chic than the Brazilians, you know, we want more fashion than, you know, just selling. And the Chilean said other points, right? And in the end, you know, we tested all of the banners, and in the end, the Brazilians, the banners that we used here in Brazil, they were also the ones that performed the best in the other countries. So I think despite the differences, you know, we have a lot of similarities there as well.
Beautiful, beautiful. And now we're going to get to the questions from the audience, whether it's for Malte or Pedro. Please come to the microphone and ask your questions. We have one here.
Boa tarde. Minha pergunta é para o Malte. Eu sou um empreendedor também, eu tenho AmoMuito.com, uma empresa que vai completar agora 4 anos de vida. É uma empresa de acessórios femininos, tem cerca de 10 mil produtos. A gente recebeu um investimento de um fundo carioca em 2012 e a gente vai abrir agora para próximas rodadas. E a grande preocupação, na verdade, é que os investidores, principalmente americanos, né, de fora, estão completamente desacreditados com o Brasil, com as empresas do Brasil. E a Dafit é um caso impressionante de investimento. A gente sabe que foi investido muito dinheiro, inclusive recentemente, nos próximos negócios da Dafit. A minha pergunta, na verdade, são duas. Primeiro, você acha que historicamente não aconteceu isso, né? Não tem nenhum fundador brasileiro que conseguiu a verba de investimento que a Dafit conseguiu. Se é possível isso acontecer? E a segunda é, como é que você consegue ter tanta confiança para os investidores, seja russo, americano, que para investir no negócio seu e se eles detêm a maior parte do seu negócio?
Bom, eu acho principalmente, eu acho que com certeza vai ter um fundador brasileiro que vai conseguir um investimento desse também. Acho que no final das contas os investidores sempre olham os números, o teu business plan. Se você está cumprindo o business plan, eu acho que não vejo porque a nacionalidade do fundador deveria determinar quem deveria receber esse investimento. Então, primeira pergunta, eu acho, com certeza. Como isso, bom, é a mesma coisa para a gente. Eu acho que a gente começou aqui com um investimento já bastante alto, com o nosso fundo, a nossa incubadora da Rocket, da Alemanha, e depois isso nos deu a oportunidade de realmente crescer bastante rapidamente. Então, como a gente conseguiu o crescimento que os primeiros investidores já prometeram para viam antes, eu acho que isso convenceu depois os novos investidores. E eu acho que uma coisa que eles também perceberam sempre quando eles numa visita nos nossos escritórios é que a gente realmente começou aqui para montar uma empresa sustentável. Do primeiro dia, a gente já optou para não terceirizar, por exemplo, a nossa logística. A gente falou que do nosso primeiro investimento, a gente vai gastar um belo valor já num centro de distribuição próprio. A gente investiu num atendimento ao cliente próprio. A gente realmente decidiu bem no início já que a gente quer criar uma empresa sustentável, que não apenas vai dar um pico e depois voltar, mas realmente com uma operação também que sustente o crescimento. E eu acho que isso também foi importante para todos os investidores que, no final das contas, investiram.
Wow, those sounded like very long questions and answers. Who else would like to ask a question? I think we have one more.
Hi. My name is Hassan. I'm from Opa Design, working here in Sao Paulo. Question for Malte. What would you recommend for a company starting up here in Brazil, or maybe one of the other BRIC countries? As we've heard a lot that customer service and customer satisfaction is an important thing for success in e-commerce. And a big factor of customer success would be fulfillment and logistics. Would you recommend a starting company to do a third party in the beginning, and then maybe as they grow and scale, do it in-house, or start from the beginning doing in-house fulfillment logistics?
Yeah, so I actually just mentioned that in my prior answer. So we decided to do actually outsource our logistics. So we started with our own distribution center from day one. We invested heavily in our logistics, and You know, we in the beginning of this year we also moved into our new warehouse, which will, you know, then give us enough room for growth over the next 2 years, for example. So I strongly believe that you should have everything in-house.
It will cost you, but yeah. And we might have a question, one more question. Go ahead.
Hello, a question for Malt. I understood that Dafiti is using Magento, the Magento platform. I would like to know how important was the choice of Magento in the success story of Dafiti?
Yeah, so actually we started with Magento, but after a few months we actually migrated to our own solution. So without going into any details, but we believe that building our company also on our own IT infrastructure made more sense.
Uma pergunta para o Pedro. Visualizando que o e-commerce no Brasil está crescendo, está se organizando, você que faz parte aí de um conselho, qual que é a visão do Brasil para daqui a um tempo, para quem trabalha com moda, e a Dafiti pode ser um exemplo, trabalhar com padronização de tamanho, viabilizar a melhor forma de logística para não ficar dependendo de transportador ou correios? Está tendo alguma organização nesse sentido para elevar um pouco mais a venda e o pessoal confiar mais no e-commerce? Falar, ah, não sei se vai servir, se vai ficar grande. Se está tendo alguma mobilização nesse sentido.
Eu estive recentemente na ABIT, Associação Brasileira da Indústria Têxtil, e eu soube que existe um movimento para padronização do setor dos fabricantes de roupa no Brasil. Já existe uma sugestão de padrão para roupas infantis, e existe já uma agenda de padronização para os próximos anos. É uma sugestão, ainda não é uma obrigação. E esse é um entrave para a categoria de moda e acessórios no Brasil ainda. Porque as pessoas têm muito medo e muita insegurança quando compram, porque o tamanho médio muitas vezes não é médio, é pequeno, o outro é grande. Então, para a indústria brasileira, da indústria têxtil, é importantíssima a padronização. Não somente para vender no e-commerce, mas também para exportação. Então, já existe, sim, está começando com tamanho pequeno para infantil, crianças, e isso depois vai ser estendido para outros clientes.
Hi, my name is Andrea, and my question is for Julia. We have a fashion jewelry maker called Stella Geromini, and we're planning to expand all over the world. And we would like to know if in these BRIC countries, if maybe expanding to these countries, maybe using e-commerce would be a nice strategy, and how you see the luxury goods market in these places, mainly in China and Russia, and yeah. If you imagine e-commerce would be a nice strategy, or maybe going actually physically into the place?
Yeah, well, who doesn't love jewelry? Well, I think the best strategy would be to have people, local people, in any country you go to, because ultimately you need someone who speaks the language, who can deal with the government piece, setting things up. You need to have local resources to get there first. And then you need to partner up with some people who are already there that are established. It will be much easier to do so. And in our example, even Ozone Rue and the e-commerce company from UK, they're also working together through the American Business Center. And so this is something you can do as well. But the piece of the, yes, there is a market for jewelry and fashion. It also depends what kind of jewelry and fashion. Is it high-end, or if it's high-end, it might work. But you also need to know what like Russian people like. I mean, they do a lot of platinum, and they do a lot of gold. It's very different from American, for example. So you need to maybe have a different line. But some retailers, what they do, they actually go to Moscow, set up offline retail store first, and they learn a lot about the market, and they test the products right there in the first 3 months, and then they hire people locally who can set up the site and everything else, and then they launch, and it's so much easier than going with nothing. So yeah,
Anybody else? Oh, we have more. I think our assistant is running to you.
Olá, boa tarde. Meu nome é David. Eu gostaria de aproveitar a presença do representante da DAFIT, né, no palco. Com relação ao comportamento, a gente sabe que foi falado sobre padronização de tamanho, o quanto que isso impacta para o segmento de moda têxtil, né, não a moda calçado, talvez seja um pouco menor esse impacto. Qual que é o comportamento? Como a DAFIT está já no Brasil e também na América Latina, se existe a diferença do impacto do tamanho da padronização de logística reversa no Brasil, né, como que vocês enxergam isso e se o comportamento ele se assemelha nos demais países aqui?
Então, a pergunta é um pouco... Bom, a resposta depende muito do país, na verdade. O Brasil e a Argentina são países especiais porque são muito protegidos, né? Por isso também a gente tem uma indústria ainda muito forte de calçados e também de roupa que está sendo produzido aqui. Já o Chile é completamente aberto. Lá o sourcing, né, compras da mercadoria é feito completamente pela China, né, os mercados asiáticos. E lá, então, a padronização já é um pouco maior. Colômbia, por exemplo, um outro caso, né? Lá a gente compra no Panamá, na Colômbia, mas também na China, porque são diferentes marcas e o sourcing tem que ser diferente. E México também é mais mesclado. Então, depende muito do país, mas uma coisa que a gente sim pode dizer que que quando o sourcing foi feito pela China, tem outros problemas com a China, né? Com certeza, mas pelo menos os tamanhos são mais posicionados.
We have one question over there.
Minha pergunta é pro Malte. Meu nome é Jefferson. E eu queria saber minha dúvida é o seguinte. No Brasil é muito difícil você manter os benefícios para o usuário, né, para o consumidor, por exemplo, frete grátis e troca grátis. E eu queria saber qual que foi a estratégia tomada da DAFIT, assim, cobrar frete de um usuário que estava acostumado a não pagar frete.
Boa pergunta. Eu sempre vejo a oferta de uma empresa num triângulo, vamos dizer, né, que é preço, portfólio, seleção e conveniência. E ainda nos mercados mais emergentes, o preço é um fator muito importante para a compra. Dentro do preço também entra essa questão do frete, né? Então, por isso, no início a gente optou realmente para oferecer frete grátis sempre. O que a gente fez agora é a gente optou, pensando de novo naquele triângulo, de deixar um pouquinho o preço do lado e focar mais ainda na seleção de produtos. Porque com a nova política de frete, a gente consegue oferecer ainda mais produtos. Naturalmente, com frete grátis, a gente se limitava em certas faixas de preço. E eu não estou falando de produto muito básico, aqui a gente vai agora entrar o barato, né, outro nível, mas foi a estúpida pergunta que a gente não conseguia vender Havaianas certinho, porque um preço de Havaianas é R$20, não sei, 15 talvez às vezes, né? Então, isso não fazia muito sentido para a gente. Então, neste caso, a gente optou realmente para oferecer ainda um portfólio ainda maior, mais completo para o cliente, e a gente avaliou isso como um maior ângulo para nós do que essa questão do frete mesmo.
Muito bem, parabéns. Muito obrigado a todos.